sound booth this morning. Hi, Betty. Glad that you are able to join us. Hi, Pat and Carl. Good morning to you. All right, so here we go into our worship space, and we have a few people with our music team, with Zach on the piano and Anthony on guitar. Kate is here with us, and Dave, of course. And then here we have for worship this morning, and you saw that he encouraged you to pick a day and come back and sit with us in worship. We have two new members joining us today. This is Brenda and Brian, and they'll be part of the service a little later on. And then over here we have Susan, who is here is George. So happy to have you both with us today. So here we go into our worship space. Hi, Edith. Nice to see you today. Kristen, nice to have you with us today. Good morning, everyone. I am Bonnie Milam, and it's nice to have been able to welcome you to worship and also to be the worship leader for today. I love Luther's words from which Dave's sermon title comes, "Sin Boldly." I know there's a whole context to it, but I like to think that God's love and forgiveness and grace are so big that our actions should match the enormous power and freedom we have when we follow God. We should step up and speak out. It may sound like I'm saying, be bold, be strong, for the Lord our God is with you. But there is also an element of you may be wrong, or at least you may be different, or even at the very least, you may not be polite. I think of Martin Luther King Jr. in his letter from a Birmingham jail written in 1963, or was it yesterday, in 2020? He says, "On sweltering summer days and crisp autumn mornings, I have looked at beautiful churches with their lofty spires pointing heavenward. I have beheld the impressive outlines of her massive religious education buildings. Over and over, I have found myself asking, what kind of people worship here? Who is their God? Where were their voices when the lips of Governor Barnett dripped with words of interposition and nullification? Where were they when Governor Wallace gave a clarion call for defiance and hatred? Where were their voices of support when bruised and weary Negro men and women decided to rise from the dark dungeons of complacency to the bright hills of creative protest?" And King makes the statement a little later. "Whenever the early Christians entered a town, the people in power became disturbed and immediately sought to convict them for being disturbers of the peace and outside agitators." From a jail cell, Martin Luther King reiterated what Martin Luther said, "Sin boldly," or as we might say today, "Rise up." Let us hear what God is saying to us as individual Christians and as a church body, the body of Christ. Let us worship God. Let us sing together, "How Clear Is Our Vocation, Lord," and the words will be on the screen.
We have not sinned. The truth is not in us. But God looks on us and sees that sees our sin and calls us to share our unrighteousness before God, so that God and God's faithfulness might forgive us. So let us pray our prayer of confession. You've spun the heavens and formed our living planet out of rock and clay, God. When Israel was captive in Egypt, you brought them out with a strong hand that they might live as free people who are governed by justice and mercy. When sin left us alienated from you and your purposes, you came among us born in human likeness. In Jesus, you welcomed the outcast. You suffered atrocities that seemed irredeemable. You sought and found us. You forgave us and brought us to new life. You are an amazing God. So don't let us get stuck in our sins. Through your forgiveness, help us to act with boldness where we might have withdrawn and given up. Where easy street seems like the best choice, give us courage to be moved to justice and good, especially when we see wrong visited on others. Yes, we are sinners, but you came making us your children again. Help us to live up to that calling in your name. Amen. People here in the sanctuary, and I hope that you are feeling joyful in joining us in the service in your home or wherever you are. We do pray that God's peace would be with you as you participate in this service of worship today. And so I say to you, and please say back to me, the peace of Christ be with you. Greet one another in the love of Jesus Christ.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Ooh, okay.
All right. Well, unfortunately, it looks as if we are missing the children's sermon. So that did not get across to us in the way that things come for us to show. So perhaps if that happens later in the service, we'll show it then. And so in the meantime, we're going to have our reading from 1 John. And then the sermon, and go forward with the rest of the service. So, on your screens, you'll see the reading from 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. Why don't you go ahead along with me and look at this passage, and we'll read it together. This is the message we have heard from Jesus and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all our sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us of all our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. So ends the reading. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, it is said that history is written by the victors, and that is actually why so often it is distorted. The writer of 1 John is a victor, by the way. And even though he has a Pyrrhic victory, that is a victory won at too great a cost to make it worthwhile to the victor, 1 John is a letter that is written to those who had been in a huge church fight and written to those who are left in that church afterwards, the survivors licking their wounds, still angry about the trouble made by those who left and trying to convince themselves that they had done the right thing and they had made a principled stand and they should stay in that stand. Indeed, they were making lemonade out of some very sour lemons. And that may sound odd to you because of the words of 1 John that we know so well and have come to love. Like, how can we say that we love God who we cannot see while we love our brother or hate our brother or sister whom we can see? That's a wonderful reading from 1 John chapter 4. Or, beloved, we even have a song for this. Let us love one another, for everyone who knows God is born of God loveth. And the one who loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. And these are wonderful and encouraging lines. But if we put them up against what we also read in the epistle, that those who do not love are liars and they are children of the devil, then we see who John is intending by saying, if we cannot love the brother or sister that we can see. It's only those left in their little church, and everyone outside is from the devil's seed. It doesn't quite live up to, I think, what Jesus intended when he was expanding who it is that we should love, even to the end of, you know, turning the other cheek and walking the extra mile, loving our enemies, as Jesus asked us to do in the Sermon on the Mount. For the author of 1 John, the enemies are the devil's seed. Now, I'm sorry if I'm bursting anyone's bubble and saying something against these cherished words, but, you know, that's how it is, actually, sometimes. Sometimes we are faced with choices that are not good. We're gonna have a choice that doesn't work for us. If we choose one thing or the other, we're choosing the lesser of two evils, and we know we grapple with those kinds of things. This is the kind of conflict that is there in 1 John, as we read of it, that you're damned if you do, and you're damned if you don't. It's kind of like that Paul Simon song, which is not so well known, but is dear to me. If something goes wrong, I'm the first to admit it. I'm the first to admit it. I'm the last one to know. When something goes right, it's likely to lose me. It's apt to confuse me because it's such an unusual sight. My, my. I can't get used to something so right. Something so right. I'm guessing that I'm not the only one who faces such dilemmas. So theologians over the centuries have pondered such dilemmas, and they've posited that even our best and most self-effacing actions can also have their sinful aspects. If someone is down and out and I go to help, the temptation still is there to go, isn't that great that I helped somebody who is in need? I think that's why, you know, when we do kind of charitable acts, we have to be careful not to, feel like we've been the rescuer and therefore find credit in being that good helper. The martyr gets the promise of heaven for her sacrifice. The do-gooder finds himself facing the trap of becoming great now for having chosen to be the servant. I'm not quite sure that that's what the Protestant reformer Martin Luther had in mind 500 years ago when he penned that phrase, sin boldly. Actually, as I understand the context of it, Luther had a student named Philip Melanchthon, and they were debating on what was the best way to have meaning in the Lord's Supper, what was the best way to have communion. And Melanchthon was getting criticism from those in the Catholic Church about how he was doing communion, and so Martin Luther said, all of your critics be damned, just sin boldly. Just do what you need to do, and it'll be okay. And in that way, he was in the room where it happened, where you hate the sin, love the sinner. But what he was also saying was, don't be stymied by sin into inaction. Take the opportunity to do what you think is good to do, and know in some ways that God will be with you still. Recently, and yesterday was actually the funeral for Congressman John Lewis, who was laid to rest this weekend. We've been hearing in the news something of a similar sort, that he was renowned for being in good trouble. I like that. I'm a devotee, actually, of that kind of idea of good trouble. I like the phrase, sin boldly, what it has to say to us, that sometimes there's just no other option than doing wrong, than doing, making mistakes. But even so, as we have that sense of the image of God in us and are devoted to Christ, there is a way for us to not be withdrawn and to be afraid to act. We are still encouraged to act. Do your best. Act with your most courageous conscience before God and know that God's grace, even when we make mistakes in that, does forgive us. Let us act with a promise to make a difference in the other people's lives, and that's what it is, I think, to sin boldly. To still go forward with God's promise. Over the last few weeks, I've been grappling with sin with us in the sermons, and I've tried to make some what I hope are helpful points about sin. First of all, that it is a word that we have kind of exercised out of our vocabulary because it had such a sense of people using it as a club to beat people up with, and so it got kind of rejected. It's like if you did anything wrong, you were those who were at God's condemnation and judgment. That was what was upon you, and so it gave people power to make people conform to what they wanted to say as a way of avoiding God's judgment. But when we lost sin, we also lost that sense of how sin brings with it a sense of possibility of forgiveness and of renewal and of a right relationship. And in place of sin being lost, what we ended up with is a kind of either a concept of criminality or a concept of a need of therapy because of sickness. Our wrongs are either that which kind of gets to the point of saying, you've done wrong, and so therefore we're punishing you, we're exercising you out of our community, we're putting you away. Breaking the law and criminality is not the same as sin. It is a way of condemning people and indeed putting them out of mind, and we see the effects of that. Or by recasting sin as a sickness, it's where we don't have responsibility. Where it's just something that's happened to us, and maybe somebody can help fix that and heal that. But indeed, we're out of the driver's seat any longer about our agency, about our ability to act. Then I talked last week about kind of redeeming the word penance, I suppose. It's not a really great word, but how when we talk about God forgiving all our sins, which is what we talk about when we talk about Jesus, and how that does indeed give us that status to be welcomed by God, that's not the end of things, that's the beginning of things. That there's an opportunity to kind of go beyond that, because sin isn't just about our status with God, it's about our relationship with God and with one another. And when wrong is done, there are ways to address it. There are ways to heal it. There are ways that we are called to action to do things. And so repentance and penance, doing acts of contrition, doing acts of reconciliation, really go to the end of seeing how we can find that sense of the community that is promised to us in Jesus Christ. Similarly, I want to talk today about this passage from 1 John and something that is in there that is so important. It's not often that I lead the prayer confession. And this morning, actually, I thought Bonnie was going to come up here and lead it. So in the moment of being a deer in the headlights, I saw that she was still sitting in the pew. And it was my opportunity to lead this. And so I bungled a little bit of the quote from 1 John. But when I do lead the prayer confession, I try to do something before we start the prayer, and that is to quote this passage from 1 John chapter 1. If we confess our sins, if we say that we have no sin, the truth is not in us, and we deceive ourselves. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us of all our unrighteousness. It's kind of like, saying that is kind of like what it's like to start my lawnmower. Before I start my lawnmower, there's this little rubber button I press that pumps some gas into the engine. I press it 10 times. I got to press it 10 times. If I do it more, it floods the engine. If I do it less, it doesn't give enough gas to get things going. 10 times. I press it, and then I pull, and it goes, and it gets going, all right? If I say to you before we confess our sin that God is faithful and just and will forgive us of all our unrighteousness, it's a way to say to you, go ahead and confess, because I want you to know before you've done that, and during when you're doing that, and after you've done that, that God will forgive you, and God will give you blessing. I think that's so important to have that sense that God's forgiveness is there, not so that we just can be relieved and have the honesty to confess our sin, but so also we can know that we can go forward and we don't need to be stymied. God will forgive us of all our unrighteousness. So sin boldly. I think the same is true for why we then are sin boldly. We are caught in sin. We are not going to get away from it despite all our best efforts. Either we end up with some Sophie's choice of the lesser of two evils, or even by our best action, there is some selfish, self-centered motivation that taints the good that we do. Nevertheless, go forward. God, who is faithful and just, will cleanse us of all our unrighteousness. Go, love, and serve the Lord with gladness and joy. Do not hold back. Do not tame your courage to act to get into good trouble. Act. Sin. Boldly. Amen. Well, wonderfully in our service today, we have the Shields video? Well, let's show it right now. If we did hear good news that the Shields video has arrived. I knew there was a possibility that it was going to come directly to go into the computer and be ready to show. So we're going to show that, and then after that, we will receive our new members. So Shields family, take it away.
Hey, St. Andrew friends, this is Josh Shields.
Kirsten Shields.
We're coming to you from Carolyn Furnace Lutheran Camp, one of our family's favorite places. And we're going to spend the next couple of minutes just sharing the joys of summer camp. So stay tuned for some of our adventures here at summer camp, and we'll have some stories for you over the next minute or three.
He's my shield, he's my heart in the middle of the wheel, he's my lily of the valley, he's my bright and shining star. Makes no difference what you say, I'll get on my knees.
Yeah. Hi, I'm here to tell you about my favorite parts of camp. Here's one of my favorite parts is GIMP. This isn't a GIMP, it's like knotted GIMP, and then I'm going to braid it later. And friendship bracelets here. And I also just like relaxing and playing with my friends. Gaga Ball, which I can show you a bit later. I bet my dad has already. And relaxing, we have a whole bunch of hammocks up. Hammocks, hammocks, hammocks. And so, yeah, it's nice to chill out and get away from all this stuff that's happening here. Bye.
Summer camp and the outdoor ministry that it brings has been a huge part of the Shields family life even before our family was established. All four members of our family have spent multiple years attending summer camps, including Camp Glenkirk, which was operated by the DC Presbytery when Josh and Kirsten were kids.
The joy of camp has included having the opportunity to grow spiritually in natural surroundings, as well as gaining independence and developing our own personalities in the positive environment of these camps. This summer would have been our girls' fourth year at Caroline Furnace as youth campers, and also our second year attending an additional three-day family camp. But unfortunately, our plans, like many others, were changed. Fortunately, we were still able to find a way to make it to camp for a few days and experience a little spiritual and emotional restoration earlier this month.
Camp is romping through the woods, learning about how to steer a canoe and cooperate to get down the river. It's swimming in the lake, standing in the muck on the bottom, and splashing in the cold mountain runoff of the creek. It's seeing a sky full of stars after dark and thousands of fireflies twinkle in the fields and forests. It's the smell of bug spray, fresh-cut cedar, burnt marshmallows, the smoke that continually follows you around the fire circle, and a week's worth of wet, stinky, dirty clothes balled up in the bottom of a plastic bag. It's the sound of singing, crickets at night, birds in the morning, and laughter at all hours.
But most importantly, camp is about connecting with God, connecting with nature, connecting with each other. These relationships can last a lifetime on something as simple as a deck of cards. Ask us how we know.
Well, thank you to the Shields family for sharing with us. I really appreciate so many of the families who have done videos of places they have gone to enjoy refreshment outdoors a lot of times over this month of July. In August, we're going to try to get kids to talk to us about their friends, how they're having friendship during this time of COVID-19. That could be with a pet, it could be with mom and dad or brother and sister, or maybe there's some other way that they're be able to practice some kind of safe friendship. So we are so appreciative of our children and our families supplying us with these kinds of ways of exploring the world as best we can while staying safe in this time of COVID-19. Now we are going to have the special delight of having a reception of new members, which was something great to be able to do during this time. We actually did meet in the sanctuary for 3 out of the 4 meetings that we had. One was on Zoom. If there's others who are interested in becoming a part of our church community, we would welcome you to do that. Just let me know and we'll arrange for another one of these Believing and Belonging classes. But I wanted to introduce the 3 members that we are receiving today. Susan Fish Johnson here to my left and your right is also a very intimate close friend with George Casuto, who we all wonderfully know. And Susan lives up in Frederick, Maryland. This is the St. Andrew membership in dispersia or whatever that word is, way out there. We know there are people watching as far away as Michigan and Texas and maybe even California. So we feel so wonderful that our church family can extend to faraway places. Even in Haiti, I believe, there are people who are watching. So Susan is close by in Frederick. She is one who in her work dyes yarn and teaches quilting, which is just a wonderful fit with, I know, many in our St. Andrew community. And then to my right and to your left are Brian Steffens and Brenda Tester. And Brian is transferring his membership here from the Ashburn Presbyterian Church. I know Kate, who's in the room, also came from Ashburn, and we heard many wonderful things about the Ashburn Presbyterian Church ministry from Brian. He is here with his now fiance, Brenda Tester. Brian lives in Winchester. He was a band director in the Loudoun County Public Schools and Fairfax Public Schools before his retirement not too long ago. And we weren't going to let that out because we didn't want Zach to hear it. I didn't want Zach to hear it until Brian might come to the choir, and then I could be the one in line to get one of Zach's pies, which he promises to anybody who recruits somebody to the choir. I just want to let that known, be known to you. It's a great incentive for being in the choir. Brenda Tester does live here in our Percival community, and she is a dental hygienist and loves her work. And both Brian and Brenda have a family, as does Susan. They have, I don't know, let's see, I'm going to guess you have about 10 children between the three of you, if I'm about right. Four, Susan, and two, well, okay, eight. So we're close to 10. Anyway. We are so delighted to have you join us. I'm going to ask you questions that we ask and everybody joining the church, and please answer from your heart and spirit. Susan, Brian, and Brenda, who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior.
Do you trust in him? Do you?
Yes.
Do you intend to be his disciple, obey his word, and show his love? Do you? And most importantly, will you be a faithful member of this congregation, giving of yourself in every way? And will you seek the fellowship of the church wherever you may be? Will you? We are so delighted to have you. I know that it's hard to greet our new members. We'll try to get their names in our directory somehow or something like that. So maybe you could even send them a card or a letter or a phone call. I'll have our Secretary Diane put that out to our congregation so that you can welcome them in whatever way you can do that. But we're delighted. We are just wonderfully delighted to have you as a part of our congregation. And we know you bring gifts to us, indeed, but we especially pray and hope that we bring a gift of community and of God's love to you as you worship and serve with us. Thank you so much for being here today, and we're really glad that you come in and worship. Let's have a prayer if we can. Dear God, thank you so much for Susan, Brian, and Brenda and their joining into our congregation. We thank you for the time of learning that they had, and it broader actually than just the three of them, and for everybody's engagement in that class, the Believe in Belonging class. We thank you that you add to our church those who are part of that fellowship of Jesus Christ, and so that we can increase our sense of following after you in the good way that you call us to live, that we can serve and love you, that we can even do so making mistakes so that we sin boldly. So bless these, our new members, as they receive the gifts of this congregation and add their own. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, we're going to have our weekend update that is shared with us by Clark and Mitch Seipt.
Hello, everyone. Good morning.
Hi, St. Andrews.
Welcome to your weekend update. I'm Clark Seipt.
I'm Mitch Seipt.
Who are you?
I'm Hannah Seipt.
Who are you?
I'm Megan Seipt.
Megan Seipt. She's part of the Connecticut Seipt. And we are coming at you live from Addison, New York, today on a beautiful, beautiful day with the, what mountains are behind us?
I think they call them the Alleghenies here.
Alleghenies. I have an advanced degree in geography.
Appalachian.
Appalachian. You said it right. Your parents.
Whatever. This is one of my happy places. We're just happy to be up here. Haven't seen my family since New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
So it's good to finally get together.
Oh, I hear a four-wheeler behind us. We are on our beasts for the week. But we'll tell you more about those later. Why don't we do some updates?
Sure.
We have two announcements for you today, only two, both of which are important. So listen up, because these are things you're not going to want to miss moving forward. It is almost August, which is hard to believe. Next time we gather, it will be August. And not next weekend, but the weekend after, Sunday, August the 9th, starts our four-week series, Conversations on Race and Racism, taking this on as the St. Andrew community. And you've heard over the last several weeks about Zoom-based small groups that'll be happening after the service, starting August 9th for four Sundays in a row. The sermon's gonna present a topic. We'll have some prompt questions to go through as small groups. And I think it's gonna be a really interesting and I hope thought-provoking, possibly even transformative time for our community. And I'm excited about it. Those sign-up geniuses are going out soon. So check out your email, look on the St. Andrew Facebook page. Sign up for one of those small groups. We anticipate having anywhere from 10 to 15 of those groups that'll gather each Sunday. Some are gonna meet in person in people's homes. Some are gonna be entirely Zoom-based. You get to decide what you're comfortable with, but don't miss that opportunity.
And just, we hope you give it a shot. You know, we hope that everyone gets in one of these groups and gets involved. But you don't even have to talk to be a part of the conversation.
That's a good point.
You know, just listening is sometimes just as powerful. So, you know, we recognize completely this can be a very uncomfortable topic, but it's one that we need to get into as a community, as a nation.
And I think sometimes when it's uncomfortable is when you know you need to be at that table, right? Do you have something to share about that?
Not me.
Okay, can we finish our announcements first?
Yeah.
Okay, very good.
All right, our second announcement, Loudoun Hunger Relief, still looking for volunteers. With so many people on vacation, they're trying to consolidate things. So it's coming up. There's going to be opportunities Tuesdays and Wednesdays, first week in August and the third week in August, for both picking up produce from their center in Leesburg and bagging it up and distributing it on Wednesdays at the Percival Commons? Main Street Commons.
Main Street Commons.
So it's been a great experience for us as a family. We've participated in all the different levels of it. It's just a nice way to give that back to those in need.
Yeah, and it's fun. I mean, you get to get out and talk to people. I really enjoyed it. Hannah, did you like when we packed up the produce and then got to go hand it out to folks?
Yeah.
That was fun, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. So yeah, look for those sign-up geniuses as well. Diane will send those out by email and on the Facebook page. Uh-oh. That's the end of Wack Up's update.
And drive.
Maggie is my cousin. Have you have a nice day.
Bye. Have a nice day. Have a wonderful, wonderful Sunday. Enjoy your week. And this is Weekend Update. Have a good one.
Thank Clark and Mitch for sharing with us. And Hannah, it's nice to have you and your cousin there with you. I want to see if I can share a couple of things on your screen. The first is, yesterday was the wedding of Jessica Carneal to Rashawn Chowdhury, and it was a wonderful gathering at Morven Park. I have a picture, I hope that Tom can put up, of the happy couple. Tom, is that possible? Oh, he can't do it? Oh, darn. I know that we also had a video of the mother-daughter first dance with Christina Carneal, but it came in kind of sideways. I don't mind if it was sideways, if you could show it in any way possible, but because it was just so fun to see Christina up there dancing with Jessica. So, well, if that comes up, we'll display that. Some other prayer concerns that we do have to share, or joys, are that Robin L. had prayers for her nephew Sean's surgery and her brother-in-law for knee surgery. So we want to continue to keep them in our prayers. Kim P., who is here in the sanctuary, unfortunately lost his Aunt Dot last week to a heart attack. And our condolences to your family, Kim, and prayers for your comfort in your grief. Also, prayers for Kim's brother, Chip, who has a lot of back pain, and I'm gathering from the way Kim is nodding that it's continuing today. So It's better. That's so good to hear. Well, Chip, we are still keeping you in our prayers if you are watching. Sue S. And her husband Roberto are having an anniversary today, and we congratulate them. But Sue last week sent a prayer for her daughter and family as they travel, and we hope that they had a wonderful trip. Today, we have a prayer request again from Robin for Sean, her nephew, as he recovers from open-heart surgery. A joy that he is home and recuperating. And also Janet prays for her son, Daniel, who is in basic training at the Great Lakes Naval Station. I know he's there in training to be a, if not a Navy SEAL, then an Army Ranger. So I think it's the Navy that he's in. But COVID is a part of what's going on, even as young men and women are in training for our service in the nation. So we want to keep Daniel in our prayers today. We have another prayer concern from Courtney to pray for California, Texas, Arizona. I'm going to add that one, Courtney, and Florida, as they have a serious rise in COVID cases. And indeed, it is all around our nation. And we pray for those in these hot spots, but we pray for especially those who are in the medical field as they do their best, especially seeking to develop a vaccine, thank you, and so that their health could be restored to our nation. We do pray for those who are in political leadership and the decision-making that they are tasked with, the responsibilities they have, that they would be making choices that would help us to be safe, even as they also guard the sense of our work as a people in our country. And we pray for teachers and students and families. As in our area, we look to have distance learning in the Loudoun County schools. Over in Clark County, I know they're gonna do hybrid kind of thing. So we wanna keep both those school districts in our prayers today. Chris Henderson is 250 miles from Mount Katahdin on his quest to walk the Appalachian Trail. And Zach, we hope that your dad is doing well. Looks like he's doing all right up there. Some difficult part of the Appalachian Trail that he's walking now. So especially prayers for him. Let's pray together. Will you join me, please? God, we thank you that you hear us as we say these prayers. We remember that story that Jesus told of the sinner who beat his breast and prayed, "Have mercy on me, Lord," while the righteous one stood next to him and was kind of assured that God's grace was with him. Help us to be like that one who asks for your forgiveness in a sincere way, but knows that even in the depths of our experience of life, even where we are trying to do right but don't see the hidden sin in our attempts, even in all those places, you hear our prayers and you respond to us. So we pray for the COVID, especially those who are on the front lines, essential workers, sometimes doing things as probably meaningless as landscaping, but who risk their lives to do that kind of work in construction and working the grocery stores, carrying mail and the like, for those who are on those front lines, especially those in the healthcare provision, that you would bless them with safety today. And we give thanks for their sacrificial work. We pray for those in service in our military, including Daniel and those who are training with him, that you would guard and protect them from COVID as they seek to gain skills that would be helpful in bringing peace to the world, which is, I know, the goal of our military ultimately is to bring peace. We pray for our cities where people are protesting, and sometimes it gets out of hand, but we pray for judiciousness and a sense of being able to work in a positive way to de-escalate the violence from police and federal troops who are there. We pray for ways in which our country can have a focus on the good that we could be about rather than a destruction and animosity. We pray for Robin's nephew and thankful for the joy of knowing that he is home and recuperating, but pray for him as he continues to recover from surgery. We pray for Chip, thankful for the good news of his lessened pain. We pray with Sue and Roberto, and thanks for their anniversary today. We're thankful for our new members here, and we are especially thankful this day for Jessica and Rashawn Chaudhry and their newly married state, and for their families and friends who were blessed to participate in the wedding, either in person or remotely. And we pray your blessing on this couple. Hear us as we say those prayers and others that are on our hearts and minds this day, praying in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. All right. So we are encouraging you to send in your pledges of and other offerings today. I'm glad for this reminder because I know I have a check in my pocket that I need to write out and put in the safe as the worship service concludes. Are we going to sing the doxology? Well, let's sing the doxology. Join with us at home as we give thanks for our opportunity to give even as God has given to us.
Would you pray with me, please? And I'm going to throw in a prayer request from Deb and Tom, who asked that we pray for the birth of their first granddaughter. We're very happy for them. God, your gifts are gracious, and we are thankful recipients. So we give in order to expand your goodness to others. May our money and our service bring loving change and righteousness in our community and in our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I don't know who gave the flowers today.
The Barbara Gallows.
Okay, for John going off to teach in school for a wedding anniversary. But they are just lovely. So thank you, Barbara Gallows, for beautifying our sanctuary today with these lovely flowers. We're going to conclude our worship service now with a song from 1 John 4, 7, and 8. Beloved, let us love one another.
Thank you.
Friends, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. Go out and, yes, indeed, you're going to sin badly, but sin boldly, especially if you get in some good trouble. God be with you. Great peace to you. Love and serve the Lord.